العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد الحمد لله It is a great honor and privilege to have been invited by Sheikh Yusuf and by the Masjid Management Board and Committee to deliver a short lecture about the importance of Tazkiyyah and about the importance of purification of the heart and how it has become a forgotten obligation not only of the month of Ramadan but in general. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He accepts this afternoon's program. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He rewards all the brothers and sisters who have participated in arranging this program in this world and also in the hereafter. Ameen, thumma ameen. Like I mentioned in the introduction, that this term or this word Tazkiyyah, there are various other words which has been mentioned, such as Ihsan, such as Suluk, and such as Islah. And in essence, all these words means one thing, and it means the same. And that is that Ihsan or Tazkiyyah or Islah means to rectify one's heart, is to cleanse your heart from all the diseases of the world, is to purify your heart from greed of this world. As mentioned in a hadith which can be found in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that the heart of an old person, the heart of the old man becomes young in two things. So the older we get, the more younger we are becoming regarding two things. One of them was Tulul Umar, i.e. longevity in life. So the older we get, the younger we become in terms of hoping and wanting to live a more longer life. And that's why you see nowadays many people, when they die, they store their organs, sometimes their bodies in fridges, so that if there is any advancement later on in the future where you can be brought back to life, then they'll want to be brought back to life. And the second thing which a person is becoming younger in despite his old age is greed of dunya, hirsud dunya. So as I was saying, that what is Tazkiyyah in essence? It's about freeing our heart from the greed of the world. It's about freeing our heart from jealousy, from hatred, and from malice. And this topic of Tazkiyyah or Ihsan is in fact an obligation of our deen. And there is no better place to start today's lecture than to look at the very famous hadith known as Hadith Jibril. This hadith can be found in many, many books of hadith. And it is called Hadith Jibreel because Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came in the form of a person to ask Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam certain questions. In the authentic ahadith it says, La ya'rifuhu minna ahadu, that there was no one from amongst us who recognized him. In another narration, it says that when he came, there were no traces of journey or dust on his clothes. So he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he asked three questions. The first question he asked was, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِسْلَامِ, inform me about Islam, which then becomes what we call the five pillars of our religion. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam answered that Islam means shahadatu an la ilaha illallah, to testify there is no God except Allah. Wa iqamu salah, to establish salah. Wa ita'u zakat, to give zakat. Wa sawmu ramadan, and to fast in the month of Ramadan. And the fifth pillar was to perform Hajj if one is able and capable of doing so. Then the next question he asked Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِيمَانِ, inform me about Iman, which then leads us to what is known as the six articles of faith, which is the أَن تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ. Iman means to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَرُسُلِهِ, to believe in his messengers. Every single prophet from Adam alayhi salatu wasalam to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. To believe in his books. To believe in his angels. Number five is to believe in life after death. And number six is to believe in fate, the good and the bad. So that was the second question asked by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Number one was, what is Islam? Number two was, what is Iman? And the third question, and this is what I said, that Tazkiyyah being a part and an obligation of our deen, not just the obligation of Ramadan, not an obligation of those who kind of like to do more dhikr. No, it's an obligation of every single one of us. Because the third question which Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam asked was, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ الْإِحْسَانِ. And the answer Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave was, أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَهُ, that you worship Allah as though you can see him. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ, and if you cannot see him, then remember, فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ, he can see you. And in essence, the hadith is telling us that ihsan means that you have to free your heart from all types of anxieties and grief, all types of hubbud dunya, love for the world, all types of spiritual diseases, and focus yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Focus your attention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as though that you can see him. That, brothers and sisters, in essence, is what is tazkiyah. Is to kind of lead ourselves such a pure life, a good life. Doesn't necessarily have to be a perfect life, because life will be of mistakes anyway. But to live a good life where we feel content in our hearts, to live such a life where we are away from the attention of the dunya and the difficulties of the dunya, to live such a life where we can taste the sweetness of our prayers and the sweetness of our fasting and the sweetness of all the good deeds which we are doing. And to tell the truth, brothers and sisters, in the month of Ramadan, we do get a taste of that. In the month of Ramadan, alhamdulillah, it's already been 2 days. But over the past 2 days, when we have prayed, we have enjoyed our prayers. When we have prayed Taraweeh, we have enjoyed our Taraweeh. Over the past couple of days, yes, it does help that the shayateens are chained up in the month of Ramadan. But even then, we still haven't had that urge to commit a sin or to do something wrong or bad. And we do feel what it is to be in such a state when our heart is cleansed and purified in the month of Ramadan. But the reality, brothers and sisters, is that that should be the case all throughout the 12 months. It shouldn't just be for the month of Ramadan. Every day of our life should be such that we are content and we can focus and we can place all our attention so that we can gain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that in a nutshell is what is meant by tazkiyyah, and that what is meant by ihsan or islah. And yes, there are many of these words around. But in essence, the name of the game at the end of the day is فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ فِي جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدُونَ. In other words, the name of the game is what? Is to have more good deeds over bad deeds. To have more good actions over bad actions. And on the day of judgment, if your scales are heavier, then you will enter Jannah. But if your scales are lighter, there's more sins than good deeds, then you will enter into Jahannam. And in essence, that's what it is all about, isn't it? Like, why do we do good deeds? It's so that we can enter Jannah. We are not doing good deeds so that we don't enter Jannah. At the end of the day, all the good we do in our life is so that we can save ourselves from the hellfire. That is it at the end of the day. We are not doing good deeds so that we can post it on our social media, on our Facebook, on our status. At the end of the day, our purpose in this world is so that we can do good deeds and we can enter Jannah. And tazkiyah and islah helps you in achieving that. Because if your heart is not cleansed and purified, and you are doing good deeds, but if your intentions are wrong, then those good deeds which you are doing will count for zero and will count for nothing in the hereafter. If you prayed, but if your prayer was such that you were doing it to show off, you fasted, but you fasted with the intention to please someone else, you gave charity or zakat, but you did it with the intention to show off, with the intention of name or fame. So even though they are good deeds, but because your intention was corrupt, then those good deeds will then become a burden for you on the day of judgment. So we could see, brothers and sisters, how important it is to make sure that our hearts are purified, it is cleansed, it is free from greed and from sins, but also at the same time to lead a pure life where you don't want to kind of hear anything bad about anyone else. It is mentioned a hadith which can be found in Tirmidhi and Abu Dawud and also of Sunan Ibn Majah, that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say to his companions that don't say anything about someone and bring it to my attention, because I don't want to think bad about this particular person. Sometimes it happens, doesn't it, where you don't want to hear about someone, but what they do, what some people will do, they'll come and they'll say, Sheikh, Mufti, Maulana, so-and-so is like this, so-and-so is like that. Even though what they may be saying about someone could be something innocent, could be something innocuous, but even then what happens subconsciously, because you heard something about someone, what happens is that it's in your mind that this person is like this. Even though he himself may not have done anything to you directly, but because some people have said something, it plays on your mind. Even that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his companion, don't say these things about your companions, about my companions to myself. Because I want to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala having a clean heart. And that is the highest level of having a clean heart, that thinking good of everyone, not even listening to any comments or anything which perhaps may have been said about an individual, but to kind of ignore anything and everything which is said, and to have the full cleanest and the purest of hearts, that is the highest level of Tazkiyyah and the highest level of Islam. And this is what is mentioned in the Holy Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, إِذْ جَاءَ رَبَّهُ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, where he talks about the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, that when he met his Lord, بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ, and a clean, pure heart means that. In other words, to meet Allah without any thoughts, without any blemishes, without even thinking negative about someone, without having bad thoughts about any individuals, that is what is known as the highest level or the highest degree of Tazkiyyah and Islah, where you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you don't even think bad about someone. Now, why is it that our hearts become corrupt? Why is it our hearts become corrupt? Now, there are two reasons as to why our hearts become corrupt. Number one is corruption in knowledge, and number two is corruption in actions, or in other words, you can say sins. Number one, corruption in knowledge. This is kind of mentioned very frequently in the Holy Quran about the Jewish rabbis. It is mentioned frequently that they had knowledge of the Torah. And in the Torah, it was quite clearly mentioned the attributes of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was quite clearly mentioned that the final prophet will emerge from Yathrib, which is modern day Medina Munawwara. This is why all the Jews had settled in Medina Munawwara waiting for the final prophet to emerge. So they had knowledge of the Torah, but because they did not want to lose their position as being a leader and as being the rabbis, what they started doing was they started concealing verses about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If they didn't conceal those verses, they started misinterpreting the verses in such a way that they kept their followers under their control and did not allow them to become the follower or followers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So corruption in knowledge, number one, destroys the heart. And this is why in the Holy Quran, how many places Allah says, ثُمَّ قَسَتْ قُلُوبُكُمْ, the hearts of the Jews became hard. And then they themselves used to make fun of that. And they used to say, وَقَالُوا قُلُوبُنَا غُلْف, that our hearts are closed. They used to make fun out of that comment. They used to say, oh, our hearts are closed. Because they knew that because of them corrupting the knowledge and the ilm which Allah gave them, their hearts over time became hard, rock solid. And we're kind of seeing this now as well at the moment, that they're showing no mercy to the people of Palestine. So the first way the heart becomes hard and corrupt is corruption in ilm and knowledge. And the second way a heart becomes hard or corrupt is through sins. The very famous hadith of Sunan al-Tirmidhi, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, when somebody commits a sin, a nuqtatun sawda, a black dot appears on the heart. If he commits another sin without doing tawbah, another dot appears. And if he keeps on sinning without repenting, then over time his entire heart becomes black and hard. In another narration of Mishkat al-Masabih and Tirmidhi, and also of Sahih Muslim, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained how the heart becomes black and hard. And he says, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained, that think of it to be like you have water in a glass, and at the bottom of the glass you have mud and dust. So just imagine there's a bottle, water inside, and at the bottom of the bottle you have all the dust. Now if you were to turn the bottle upside down and shake the bottle, what would happen to the dust? The dust will be flying around, whizzing around every single part of the bottle. In this exact way, when somebody commits a sin and a dot appears, it's not like the dot is only at the bottom of the heart. It's not like the third dot or the fifth dot or the tenth dot is at the bottom, where you could argue and say, okay, at least the top part's good, but the bottom part's bad. So at least the top part being good, the positive of that is at least you could still do good deeds. No. The dot is scattered all across every single part of the heart. That, in other words, I'll give you an example. If there's like bread, a slice of bread. Now, if the mold is on every single part of the bread, what are you going to do? You're going to throw it away. If the mold, say for example, was on one part of the bread, at least you could throw that part away and eat the rest. But when the mold is on every single part of the bread, on the crumbs, on the main part, on the side, on the top, on the bottom, there's no use of that bread. You have to throw it away. So exactly when somebody commits a sin, the black dot is across every part of your heart. And there is no benefit of the heart anymore. So these are the two things which corrupts the heart. Number one is corruption in knowledge, and number two is in sins. And just very briefly, as we're talking about the topic of sins, the great scholar Ibn Qayyim Rahimullah has mentioned 40 ill effects of committing sins. Now, we don't have time to mention all of them, but just a few I'll mention, especially as they are, mashallah, some students of knowledge here as well. That one ill effect of committing sins is that it leads to lack of remembering your ilm and your knowledge. To preserve your knowledge becomes difficult. We know the very famous story of Imam Shafi'i rahimullah and his teacher Waqiyah. So he complained to his teacher about loss of memory or lack of memory, lack of preserving his knowledge. So what did the teacher say? He said to him that ilm is nur, and nur or ilm cannot be given to a sinner. So when you commit sins, the ill effect of committing sins, number one, is that lack of memory. Also, number two, when you commit sins, you are also preventing or depriving yourself from risk and from provision. To mention the hadith of Sunan Ibn Majah, that when somebody commits sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he then curtails and restricts the risk and the provision which you were meant to get. Also, committing sins reduces your lifespan as well. And we see this with our eyes, like those who are drug dealers, druggies, those who are alcoholics, that in their late 40s, early 50s, they'll have a heart attack. Now, yes, they are dying because of their liver or because of other reasons, other medical reasons. But even from an Islamic perspective, it is down to the fact that when you commit sins, when you do evil, then over time what happens is that your body cannot contain the evil and the sins which you are doing, which is then leading you to kind of pass away and lose your life very, very quickly. So these are some ill effects of committing sins. Now, as I was saying, that the two reasons why our heart becomes corrupt, number one is because of corruption in knowledge, and number two is because of the sins and the evil acts which we are doing. Now, how do we attain Tazkiyyah and Ihsan? What things can we do to kind of purify our hearts and gain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Now, it goes without saying, there are some things, and these things are basic and easy to do. And going back to the point which I mentioned right at the beginning of today's talk, about why is it in the month of Ramadan we can feel and taste the sweetness of ibadah and worship. Why is it that in the month of Ramadan, we don't get the urge or the inkling to commit sins? Why is it in the month of Ramadan, we want to listen to good, and we want to be in a good environment, and we want to spend more time in the masjid than anywhere else? And the reason why is because the things which the Sharia and which Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told us to attain tazkiyyah, we do that abundantly in the month of Ramadan. And that is ibadats or actions such as reciting the Quran. When you read the Quran, and when you read it regularly and abundantly, automatically the black dots of the heart, you are washing them away, you are cleansing them away. The very famous hadith of Sunan al-Bayhaqi, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, "Kullu shay'in saqalatun." Everything needs a polish. Everything needs a polish. وَالسَّقَالَةُ الْقُلُوبِ, and the polishing of the heart is dhikrullah, is the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So reading Quran, which is also a form of dhikrullah, automatically brings about purification of the heart. Reading Quran, reciting the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doing tasbih, which is so simple and easy to do, that also brings about closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The very famous hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, also of Riyaz Salihin, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are two things, khaslatan, there are two things which are very easy to do, but the ones who are acting upon it, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلُ بِهِ مَا قَلِيلٌ, are very few. What are the two things? Number one is to do, or is to recite Subhanallah 10 times, to recite Alhamdulillah 10 times, and to recite Allahu Akbar 10 times after every salah in a day. So not the full 100, just 10 times Subhanallah, 10 times Allahu Akbar, and 10 times Alhamdulillah. That is 150 tasbih in a day, but 1,500 on the scale. Because for every tasbih you get 10 rewards. So 150 on the tongue, but 1,500 on the scale. Then on top of that, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam instructed us a second thing to do, and that is to recite 100 tasbih before we go to sleep. So again, 100 on the tongue and 1,000 on the scale. 33 times Subhanallah, 33 times Alhamdulillah, and 34 times Allahu Akbar. So in total, you are ending with 2,500 good deeds. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the Sahabas that, how many of you commit 2,500 evils a day to be in credit? Like, in other words, one sin you commit, you get one evil deed written against you. So if you can do this, what I've just mentioned, you're ending up with 2,500 good deeds. You have to do more than 2,500 sins to be in debt. And no one does 2,500 sins. Yes, we may do some sins, but it won't be 2,500 in a day. So even if you do 100 sins, you're still in credit. You still got 2,400 good deeds to play with. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that to the Sahabas then said to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that these two actions are so easy. These two actions so easy. Why is it that people don't do it? So then Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam explained that what happens is that when we pray salah, when we are praying salah, shaitan comes. And shaitan tells us that, oh, after salah finishes, after the imam gives the salam, you've got this to do, you've got that to do, you have to make a call, you have to message someone, you have to go here, you have to do some grocery shopping, you have to do this, you have to do that. So what happens as soon as the imam finishes his salah, what do? We don't have time for tasbih. We just straight away get up and we go. And then at night time, when it's 100 tasbihs, is it so, you know, we have time to browse on our social media before we go to sleep. We have time to see a YouTube video before we go to sleep. Reciting 100 tasbihs should take 1 minute. It's so easy to do. But what happens is that the moment we put our phone down, so when we got our phone in front of us, the screen in front of us, we are awake. But the moment we put it down and we want to read the tasbih, shaitan comes and then he, you know, tells us, oh, you've had a long day, you know, you've been very busy, you've been traveling, you've done this, and he just pats you to sleep and you go to sleep without reading the 100 tasbih. So the point I'm trying to make is that some of these actions, such as reciting Quran, zikrullah, tasbih, they are the key ibadats and worships which we need to do to gain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's something else where you can attain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and attain Islah and Tazkiyyah, which is, I'll say, the most important part, is being in the company of the good and the pious people. If there aren't pious people around to be in the company with, then being in the masjid is the next best thing. And it goes back to that point I already made, that why is it in the month of Ramadan we automatically feel content and happy and we have attained spirituality? Why? Because we are in the masjid most of the day anyway. We are here from Fajr, we are here for Dhuhr, we are here for all the prayers. From Asr, Alhamdulillah, some of the brothers are listening to the lecture, you'll be here all the way until Taraweeh. Now I'm not saying that we don't commit sins in the masjid. But when we are in the masjid and when we are in a good environment, then for us to commit sins recedes compared to, say, for example, if we weren't in the masjid or if we weren't in the company of good people. The very famous hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, where Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has described Jalisu Salih, a good companion, to be like a perfume seller. In other words, when you go to the perfume seller's shop, you will either buy the perfume from him, he will either give you a sample to kind of smell or use, or the very least, when you leave from that shop, you will leave with the smell. Whereas a bad person, a bad companion, he's like a furnace. In other words, someone who's bellowing smoke from a furnace. So when you go to him, he will make you burn, or the very least, he will kind of make you leave with a foul smell. Now, do you know, when you are with good people, like today's lecture here, there's two things. Even if you don't understand, like if you understood something, then Alhamdulillah, it's good. Nurun ala nur, it's like light upon light. Good deeds upon good deeds. But then the second thing is that even if you don't understand, it doesn't matter, you are still in a good environment And even when you leave that environment, you are living, with your heart being cleansed. And more importantly, you are leaving that gathering with your maghfirah and your forgiveness being attained. And this is one nasiha I want to give to all the brothers, and I give that everywhere I go. Is a lot of the times when lectures are happening, we have this kind of notion that, oh, the lecture's a bit technical, I don't want to sit, I'd rather do something else. No, don't do that. If it's a lecture where Allah's remembrance is being done, and the salat and the salam of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being recited, never leave, even if you don't understand it. Because when you leave that gathering, the very, very least what will happen is that you are leaving with forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being attained. The very famous hadith of Sahih Muslim, where, as I'm sure you know this hadith, that wherever there's a zikrullah, wherever there's a gathering of Allah's remembrance, what happens? The angels, they visit those places, don't they? So even today's gathering, this is a form of zikrullah. The angels are present. And then they will go and tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that there was a zikr of yourself. There was a remembrance gathering of yourself, O Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will then tell the angels that I make you a witness that every single person who attended that gathering, I forgive them. Then the angels will say to Allah, O Allah, however, there was one person. There was one person in that gathering who didn't want to be there. And I'm sure even here as well, there must be at least one or two or three or five people who perhaps didn't want to attend today's gathering, but are here for other reasons. But you're just here just because of it. So the angel would say to Allah, there was someone in that gathering who didn't want to be there. Would he also be forgiven? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, yes, he will also be forgiven. If everybody else is being forgiven, the one whose intention was not to attend that gathering, he will also be forgiven by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why I say that being in the company of good people, even though you may not have understood what was being said, even though it may have been in another language, in Urdu, in Bengali, in Arabic, whatever, it doesn't matter. As long as you are there in that gathering and you're trying your best to listen and to understand, that in itself is sufficient in the eyes of Allah, and that is enough for your forgiveness. So what I want to say to everyone, just to conclude, as iftar time is slowly or soon dawning upon us, tazkiyyah. Don't take it as though that it is only for the month of Ramadan. In these few days which are coming, we will experience peak levels of tazkiyyah. We will actually experience moments where we will feel and we will be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will experience highs where the best thing in life is to listen to the Quran. We will experience life where the best moments are the moments we spend with our family and with our friends at iftar and at suhoor. There will be moments during this month where no other place incites us as much as the masajids of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do. But remember, it's not only for the month of Ramadan. Tazkiyyah is for every single day. The month of Ramadan gives us a taste of how it's supposed to be, but it's supposed to be for every single day of the year. And I leave with the hadith that, remember, purifying the heart is the most important part. The heart is the leader and the amir and the commander, and the limbs which are all connected with the heart. If the heart is good, everything else is good. So if we can get our heart to focus and we can get it to turn towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the rest of our limbs will also turn to Allah. If our heart is yearning towards pleasing Allah, then automatically our eyes will only look at those things which pleases Allah. Our eyes will never look at then haram again. Our ears will only want to listen to those things which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will not want to hear backbiting, ghibah and slandering again. And this is what is mentioned in the hadith of Sahih al-Bukhari, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there is a limb and there is an organ in your body. إِذَا صَلُحَتْ, when that organ and body is good, صَلُحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ, all the limbs are good. But وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ, but when this limb and organ becomes corrupt, فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّ, all the body becomes corrupt. أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبُ, and that organ is the heart. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gives us all tawfiq to act upon what has been said, and in particular some of the points which I mentioned about how to attain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you use this month of Ramadan to kind of remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not for yourself only but for the Muslim Ummah worldwide, in particular our brothers and sisters in Gaza. You know, pray to Allah, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be in the company of good people, attend the durus and lectures delivered by our Honorable Sheikh Yusuf, the Imam of the Masjid. Again, I would like to thank Sheikh Yusuf for inviting and for arranging this particular program. And inshallah, we kind of make sure that we use this particular month to gain nearness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the reality, brothers and sisters, is that we don't know how long we have left in this world. Death can come any time, any second. The very famous hadith, I won't go into too much detail, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, "Badiru bil a'mal sab'an," hasten to do good deeds before seven things. And one of them was mawtan mujahis, before a sudden death. So we don't know when we're going to pass away, we don't know when we're going to fall ill, when something could happen and we may end up senile. So inshallah, utilize this blessed month to do good deeds, to do good actions. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that gives us all tawfiq to act upon what has been said. Jazakallah khair for listening. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Jazakallah khairan to Mufti Sahib. Takbir. And as announced, inshallah, Sheikh Mufti will be speaking after Taraweeh as well. So please attend that as well, inshallah. Jazakumullah khairan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh.